Good morning, everybody. Oh my goodness, it's so good to see all you families and children. It's exciting. We've got communion today, and we're going to do things a little bit differently. We're going to have two of the more grown-up songs, and then we're going to have a children's song as the third one, and then we're going to finish with a slow one. But don't sit comfortably, because there's always going to be something else you'll be called up for or standing up for. Okay, so let's stand together and worship the Lord this morning. The Bible says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. That includes you. Thank you,
Jesus. We'd like to invite you, wherever you are around the world, to raise your voice and get in on singing together Psalm 150. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
You made the starry host. You paved the mountain peak. You paved the evening sky with wonders. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea. All nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing His greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice. From furthest east to west, let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Yes, we will, Jesus. We give you all honor this morning.
You reach into the dust, in love your spirit breathe. You warmed us in your baby likeness. To know your wondrous way, tell your mighty deeds, to join the everlasting chorus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing His greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice. Symphonies resound, let drums and choirs ring out. Oh, heaven, hear the sound of worship. Let every nation bring its honor to the King. A roar of harmony, eternal.
You chose me as your child, and your word is always faithful. You will not turn aside. Now I live in full assurance, for my Savior paid the price. Every promise that you made me is yes in Jesus Christ. You are faithful to your promises. Trust in what the cross has said through the ages. fire? Will you keep us in the storm? Are you still the light to guide us when the darkness overwhelms? Through the dust and through the valleys, through the passing years we find, every promise you have spoken is yes in Jesus Christ. You are faithful to your promises. We will trust in what the cross has said. For us, you will have the last amen. So we set our hopes upon this, and on this we build our lives. All your promises forever are yes in Jesus Christ. You are faithful to your promises. We will trust in what the cross has said. The ages, hallelujah, you are faithful to your promises, you are faithful to your promises. You will be our God, we will be your people, you will be faithful to your promises. You are faithful to your promises.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. So if there's any adults that were at Holiday Club or children that want to come forward to do the actions, it's up to you. We'll leave it up to you. But we're adding this song because you're special to us. Yay! Come and do the actions! Well done, you guys. These are brave people. Yay! I'm so pleased you're with us. Good job. You can join and clap if you want to.
Jesus, you died upon a cross and rose again to save the lost. Forgive me now of all my sin. Come be my Savior, Lord and friend. Change my life and make it new, and help me, Lord, to live for you. Change my life and make it new, and help me, Lord, to live for you.
Woohoo! Well done, you guys.
Jesus, you died upon the cross and rose again to save the lost. Forgive me now of all my sin. Come be my Savior, Lord and friend. Change my life and make it new, and help me, Lord, to live for you. Change my life and make it new, and help me, Lord, to live for you. And make it new. Help me, Lord, to live for you. Change my life and make it new. Won't you make it new? And help me, Lord, to live. To live for you.
Yes. The hearts cry, Jesus. To live for you. Woo. Give them all a big clap. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Good job. You did. Good job. Woo. Woo. Yay. Hallelujah. You know what? Jesus said, let the little children come. For the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. He also said, lest we become like children, we won't see the kingdom of heaven. You know, they're so precious to him. And that's why I wanted to involve them in our worship this morning, because they are so, so special. Hallelujah. We're going to finish by lifting up the name of Jesus, because he alone is worthy. Oh, I love to lift the name of Jesus, for that name has brought new life to me. So I lift that holy name, bringing glory, bringing fame to the one who gave his all for me. Oh, I love to lift the name of Jesus over all the things I've yet to see. Hallelujah to that name that's above all other names, full of power and authority. Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name, Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name. Love to lift the name of Jesus, for that name has brought new life to me. So I lift that holy name, bringing glory, bringing fame to the one who gave his all for me. Oh, I love to lift the name of Jesus over all the things I've yet to see. Hallelujah to that name that's above all other names, full of power and authority. Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name. Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name. Jesus, we cry out to you, Lord.
is power in your name. Power in your name.
This morning, if you believe that there is power in the name of Jesus, if you have a need that only God knows about, if you have a desire, if you have a hunger for the things of the Lord, we're going to cry out Jesus again. And I want you to bring that thing to him. Maybe you're struggling with something. Bring it to him. There is power. Not just power, but holy power. Power given by authority of the Father. In the beginning, the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And the Word came and dwelt amongst us. And now he reigns on high in heaven, sitting at the right hand of the Father. He has all power and authority. And he said to his disciples that greater things would they do. So if you believe this morning, as we sing again, Jesus, there is power in your name. Just bring everything to him.
Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name. Jesus, there is power in your name, power in your name. Power in your name, power in your name, Jesus. There is power in your name, power in your name.
Oh, we do. We lift you up this morning, Jesus, high above all cares and worries, all even above our hopes and dreams here on earth. We lift you so high. We lift you because we want to honor you. We want to give you all the praise that you're due. Oh, Father God, thank you for your Son this morning. Thank you, Lord, that we can celebrate communion this morning. Thank you, God, that we can celebrate the blood that was shed and the body that was broken so that we could be made whole. Hallelujah.
Praise God. That was another wonderful time of worship, wasn't it? We have a few notices, quite a few notices this morning. So the regular midweek activity is back to normal. So on... Oh, my notes have gone... Yes, so on Tuesdays we have Little Angels. Oh, not until September. Okay, I'll skip that. On Wednesday we have Tea at 23, which is it's going very well. It's a community event, and we have cakes and tea and chat. Always very well attended, and we've missed for 2 weeks, so this week we're back in action. Then on Thursday we have Bat and Chat, if you're interested in that. That's also very, very popular. It's very relaxed. It's not competitive. It's more knock it around, but it depends who's playing on which table, because we've got a couple of tables. So if you're interested in a bit of fellowship and a bit of fun with table tennis, then we on Wednesday, 10 till 12, that's bat and chat. Thursday, I'm sorry. I had a late evening. On Saturday, 13th of August, the youth are going to be going 10-pin bowling. Still waiting for the final details on that, on the location. On Monday, the 22nd of August, if you've been with us for a while, you will remember Sue winning. She used to sit where that banner is, toward the rear, on my right, on your left. And she passed away a few weeks ago. And we're having a memorial service for Sue. I think we're going to have some songs that's still being organised at the moment from us. And if anybody would like to share some memories about Sue, then you're very welcome. And if you let me know, I'll speak to the family about that. The order of service is still being put together. So that's 22nd of August, Monday, 10:45. In here, if you would like to remember Sue, then you're welcome to come. A new thing which came out yesterday as a suggestion was that we have a fun day in the Field of Dreams. We used to do this, and we're proposing the 10th of September, Saturday, and that's in the Field of Dreams, if you know where that is. Top of Stonnell Road, and you keep going up the track. So that is 10th of September on Saturday, Field of Dreams, and we'll have some games. I think we're going to have some dancing. Wow. We haven't set a time, but we've got a little bit time to go, so we'll fix a time. But if you're free, then we were hoping to do that, have a barbecue as well. Okay, having made a complete mess of the notices, I'll hand back to Kate.
Hey Richard, you're human. Okay, 19th of August, my lovely friend Shirley over there, and Mrs. Henson, Sandy, will be hosting a ladies' art evening. I believe it's 7:30, isn't it? Seven. See, Richard's not the only one who gets it wrong. We're human. You know, isn't it wonderful that we make mistakes, but God is perfect, and he's our dad. So if we keep looking to him, we might get there in the end. Okay, so all the children, come back. Youth, you can come up if you want to. I've got some things to do here this morning. We were going to talk about, hello. Would you like to hold this for me? Would you like to hold that? That's my Harry's. And anybody, you want to hold this, Alfie?
Yeah.
You want to hold that for me? You want to hold that? You can hold that if you want. You can hold that. Okay. So, this morning we're talking about giving thanks, because yesterday we gave thanks for Jeff's 50th birthday, and we're all going to shout, hello Jeff, and happy birthday on the count of three. Are you ready? Look at that camera over there, yeah, where Richard is. One, two, three. Hello Jeff, happy 50th birthday. Yeah, you're not here, but we're still remembering you, just like we did Sue last week. Okay, so I thought it'd be good to give thanks. You know, I did a video for Jeff, because everybody had to do a video. And the one word that came to me was, thank you. So I said, thank you, Jeff, for being you. Thank you, Jeff, for being faithful. Thank you, Jeff, for being generous. Thank you, Jeff, for being kind. And it went on and on and on, because he is all those things. So, Alfie, this morning, if I get a microphone, can you tell me something that you are thankful for? Yeah, what are you thankful for?
For God making our life.
For God giving us life. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Because when I look at you, I think he did a good job. Does anybody agree? Yes. Good job. What's this you got? Hold on, sweetie. Hold on. What's this you got in your hand? What is it? It's a rainbow. What is it? It's a rainbow scarf, isn't it? So we can give God thanks for all his promises. Yeah? Shall we give God a big clap? You can hold on to that. And what have you got in your hand? Wow. What does it say? Can you read it?
Give me a pug hug.
Oh, I love me a hug. You're going to give that pug a hug? Oh, thank you, Lord, for hugs. And what have you got, young man? It's George, isn't it? Is it George or Henry?
Henry.
You're Henry, that's George. Another thing I got wrong. Okay, glad you forgive me. You've got a book. When the World Was New. I wonder what that's all about. Can you guess?
It's about God making the world and the universe and stuff.
So we can give thanks for God creating the world and the universe. Thank you, young man. Have you got anything else you're thankful for, George?
Me? Yeah. I'm thankful for having one heart, but worms having five.
You've got one heart and worms have got five. Wow, God is an amazing creator. And you, Master, you could be a biologist. You know, like, what's his name? Chris Packham on TV? Yeah? Good job. You keep going. Have you got something to be thankful for this morning?
I'm thankful that God gave his only son and let him die on the cross to forgive all of us.
Oh, hello. That is beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. Hello, young lady. How are you today? Good. What have you got to give thanks for? Have you got something to give thanks for?
Yeah, I'm thankful that I have such a great family.
Oh, Daddy. Oh, that's so cute. If I was your mum, I'd be really happy right now because you said that. Okay, and in your hand you've got, it's called In Every Tiny Grain of Sand. And it's a book full of poems, praises and songs for children. And I bought that book the other day. And I tell you, I'm so thankful for books. Books are great, aren't they? So, hello, beautiful young lady. How are you today? Have you got something you'd like to say thank you for? Have a little think.
Friends.
Friends. Where would we be without friends? Absolutely brilliant answer. And you know what? This book, Zoe and Beans, is all about Beans losing his soft toy and taking his friend, his where he lives, the girl. Yeah, because he's a dog. And he nicks her best soft toy, and it's a lovely story. But that's all about friends. So that's a real good connection you made there this morning without even realising it. Fantastic. And Shuggy, what have you got to give thanks for?
All my friends and family, and actually all the kindness the people in the kitchen showed yesterday at the party.
Oh, woo-woo! Woo-woo! And what have you got in your hand? Can you read that out to me or for everybody?
When my arms can't reach people who are close to my heart, I always hug them with my prayers.
How cute is that? And that was Maggie that sent that to me. And I thought we would print it off and put it in the log cabin. So I've got something really special for you children to do. Are you listening? Okay. Who knows Tanya? Tanya, can you put your hand up? Okay. You take that to Tanya. That's a thank you from me. You take that to Richard on the sound desk over there. Brett's not here, but we can give that to Barbara. Hey, we've got three here. If you can take it to that pretty lady over there in the pink top next to the sound desk, their thank you cards. Oh, Shuggy, you've got one. I can give it to you. Oh, but I've got one for your mum as well, because she helped with all the crafts at Holiday Club. So there's a thank you card for her. And can you take that? Pauline, where are you? Hand up. She's not here today. Okay, give that back to me, sweet boy. I've got another one. Whoop! Hello. I'm thankful he didn't hurt himself. This is for Maggie. Where's Maggie? Put your hand up, Maggie. She helped at Holiday Club. And Isabella, can you take that to Sue over there in the Navy and say thank you to Sue? And Alfie, this is for your cousin, Sally Fiangi, who helped at Holiday Club. So, guys, we are giving thanks this morning. For Jesus, we're giving thanks for God the Father and the Holy Spirit. We're going to pray. Who's ready? Anybody want to pray for me this morning and pray for everyone? You want to pray? Okay, here we go.
Thank you, God, for creating us and letting us live a happy life. In Jesus' name, amen.
And all God's children said, amen. Thank you, guys. Off you go. Oh, you want to? Oh, sorry. Someone else wants to pray.
Thank you, Father God, for creating us and making the world bigger than us. Otherwise, there will be only one person on the planet to make no friends. But there's more than a billion people, but less than, well, it's around 8 and 7 billion
That's
people.
That's right. God bless you, my son.
Yeah. So this match taught me that it's a game. Yeah. And
thank you.
If you get hurt, God might
heal you.
Yeah.
Say amen.
Jesus, his name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, guys. You can pop everything back on there. God bless you all. So we're going to have communion, and when we're finished, that's for Sally and Angie. We're going to... Oh, thank you, darling. Thank you. Bless them.
Praise God. So we're going to share communion. It's the first Sunday of the month. Isn't it wonderful that we have such a good God, that he wanted to redeem us for himself. He wanted to love us and to receive us back in his presence. And that's the Father God that we have. He did it because he loved us. He first loved us. But you know, there's something else that, another reason that he did it was he died on a cross so that we would be set free and we would be able to enter in his presence and worship him. And God desires that. He desires our worship. And he was willing to suffer and die on the cross so that we could worship him together. And it's just wonderful that we were able to enter his presence this morning. So let's give thanks to God as we share the communion together. So Jesus died on the cross so that we could be one in him, one body. Not one of us is a mistake in the sight of God. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. And he died that we would be reconciled to him and reconciled to ourselves as well. And let's take the bread now as we remember what Jesus did for us. Thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you that you were willing to go through Gethsemane, Lord, where as you were fully God and fully man, you wanted that cup to pass from you. But not what you wanted, but that what the Father wanted is what you chose, that we might be reconciled to you. And thank you that you are willing to die on the cross. Thank you that you are willing to make us clean, Lord, as we all make mistakes. You were willing to make us as clean in your sight by the blood that you spilt. And let's remember Jesus this morning as we drink the cup together. Amen. you put it onto camera 4, I think it is, for me. Oh, and the while we're doing, sorting the camera out, the children, if the children could go out with Kate to the cabins at the back. I wanted to share this morning on the power of prayer, and particularly the title is Reaching the Throne of God. Reaching the Throne of God. Because I've had this phrase in my head for a few weeks now about eternal matters, that God wants us to be about his business. And when Jesus was a boy, they visited Jerusalem for the Passover, and his family went back thinking that Jesus was with them, but he was actually in the temple and discussing the word of God with the religious leaders. And when his parents came to pick him up, he said, "Why did you worry?" Because he said, "I had to be about my Father's business." And, you know, I've had this phrase of eternal matters on my heart for quite a few weeks, that God wants us to be about his business. He wants to involve us in his purposes. And isn't it easy for us to get involved in the natural side of life, to settle for less than what God wants to give us? Do you know, if we are going to involve ourselves in the business of God and eternal matters, then we need to lose the natural stuff. Maybe there's something about the natural world that's a problem to us getting involved in the things of God and the purposes of God. Well, we need to lose a bit of the natural stuff. Do you know, Jesus said when he was teaching, a rich young ruler came up to him and said, "I've done everything that is written in Scripture." But Jesus said, "There's one thing that is holding you back. And you need to give all your money to the poor and come and follow me." And he went away sad, because that was more important. Money was more important to him than eternal matters. And Jesus said, how difficult. He said in Luke chapter 18 and verses 24 to 27, after the rich young ruler had walked away, said when in verse 24 of Luke 18, "And when Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he said, 'How hard is it for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God?' And he said, 'It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God.' And those who heard it said, 'Who then can be saved?' But Jesus said, 'The things which are impossible with men are possible with God.'" And so we need to lose some of the natural stuff that is more important to us than getting involved in the business of the Father. And Jesus said, didn't he, to his parents, "Why were you worried? Why did you seek me? Didn't you know that I must be about my Father's business?" So, do you know, I really believe that God is doing a new thing, and we need to be getting involved in the eternal matters, the business of the Father. And you know, the more we respond in that way, the more that we're obedient, the more that we put the things of God first, the more he gives us. We take a little step first, and when we do that, God gives us, here's the next step. But you know, sometimes things hold us back from doing that, and we need to lose that. We need to be involved in the Father's business. And Jesus said, didn't he, that as soon as we're faithful with the little things, he brings us into more. So I wanted to share some thoughts this morning about reaching the throne of God. Reaching the throne of God. And the first aspect is that God chooses us. God chooses us. Matthew chapter 9 and verses 37 and 38. Matthew 9, chapter 9, verses 37 and 38. Jesus said to his disciples, "The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." So God chooses us, but he chooses us like he did with the disciples to do what he did and reach the lost. And there is a harvest out there of people that are hurting in their lives, and we are God's representatives. God wants to give us his power to go and save the lost and give the message of the gospel to the lost. So Jesus sent the disciples out. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1, Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1, Jesus sent the disciples out. It says, when he had called his 12 disciples to him, he gave them power. He gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. So Jesus came from heaven to the earth. He chose his disciples and he delegated power. He delegated the power of God to his disciples. Jesus wants to do that today. Jesus delegated the power directly to his disciples. But so Jesus came down from heaven and he delegated his power to the disciples. But you know, we need to reach the throne of God and receive the power, that delegated power of God's for ourselves. We need to reach God concerning eternal matters. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 26. Isaiah chapter 40. Verse 26 says, "Lift up your eyes on high." It's talking about the night sky. "And see who has created these things, who brings out their host by number. He calls them all by name." Now there are a lot of stars, even visible to our natural eyes, but there are an immense number of stars. I can't remember the number now. Not very important, but it's a lot. And he calls them all by name, by the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. And I was thinking that when it comes to us receiving that delegated power, he chooses us. He calls his people by name. To receive his power and to do his work. So God chooses us. He's chosen us as he chose the disciples to reach the harvest, to bring in the harvest for him. And that should be our focus. That's why we get the anointing. That is why we get the delegated power, is to deal with the things that are oppressing people and show them the power of God to save. So God chooses us. God chooses us and he calls us by name. He wants us to be doing his work. He wants us to be about his business. And we need to reach the throne of God. And the second aspect is the value of earnest prayer. The value of earnest prayer. And I was reminded of Gethsemane, when Jesus prayed earnestly to the Father. It says Matthew chapter 26, verse 36 and 45. Matthew 26, verses 36 to 45. It says, then Jesus came with the disciples to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply traumatized and distressed about what he was about to go through. And then he shared with Peter and James and John, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Stay here and watch with me. He wanted his disciples with him when he was going through that terrible time where he was separated from the Father. We can't imagine, can we, what Jesus was going through. Jesus was God and is God, but he was fully human as well. And he was suffering and he prayed earnestly. And it says, verse 39, he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And then he came back to the disciples and he found them sleeping and said to Peter, what could you not watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again a second time he went away and prayed the same thing, saying, O my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done. And he came and found them asleep again because their eyes wouldn't stay open. And so he left them and went again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. And then he came to his disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. And so Judas came and betrayed Jesus to the Pharisees. So Jesus was fully human. He was fully man, and he suffered the same things as we do. And I was thinking that when we're struggling with something, that God knows what we need. When you decide to be about the Father's business, doing the things that God has asked you to do, the things you know he has asked you to do, that puts you in the firing line, and things can happen which have the potential to stop us, as with what Jesus was going through in Gethsemane. We need to trust God. We need to know that God knows our need. And when we know that he knows, then we need to trust. When we know that God knows what we're going through, then we need to trust him. And Jesus said that anything is possible. You do not need to worry about it. The situation that's stopping you from taking that step of faith. If we earnestly pray to God about the thing that's stopping us, the fear that's stopping us from doing his will, then anything is possible. We do not need to worry about the fear that we have. Anything is possible. And you know, we're going through some strange times, aren't we? We're in the end days. We're in the end time. We are in the end times where there's an increase of perplexity. Things that are happening in the world, and there's just no solution. And if you don't know God, that you must feel so perplexed and stressed and trapped. All prices seem to be doubling, don't they? I remember earlier in the year, milk was 99p, and now it's almost twice that price. We've got wars, we have pandemics that we're experiencing in these days. Do you know, when we find ourselves in an impossible situation, when you are faced with what seems to be an impossible situation, that can lead us to lose our trust in God. But Jesus said, if we can trust, if we pray earnestly to God, he will answer our prayer. And you can even doubt it when God answers your prayer. Because we're human, you look at the situation again, and you need to remind yourself of that answer to prayer. But we need to reach the throne of God, and we need to earnestly pray about the situations that we go through in this life. Because there are things that can happen. We have an enemy that does not want us to be about the Father's business. He does not want us to get involved with eternal matters. And he will cause things to happen. If we are faithful to what God asks us to do, we have an enemy that will try to stop us. And he will cause things to happen that have the potential to destroy us, to cause us to lose our trust in God. So we need to pray. We need to pray to God earnestly. And I've been going through, I will share this, I said I would share last time I spoke of it. I've been going through some difficult times with finances, situations that seem absolutely impossible. And I needed to know, is this mess of my own making, or is it of eternal importance? And I earnestly prayed to God that he would show me whether this step of faith that I'd taken was of him, because the situation seemed so impossible. It was like going from one impossible situation to the next impossible situation to another one, to the point where I was doubting whether I should ever have taken the step of faith. And so I prayed earnestly, asking God, was this of you, or did I make a mistake? It's had quite a serious impact. And it was amazing because God answered that prayer. So that prayer reached the throne of God. The prayer reached the throne of God, and God answered. And I hope you don't mind in me saying, God gave Kevin a dream, and in that dream he had a specific instruction that he told Kevin to say to me, which he shared with me. I didn't understand it properly at first. And then he put a word in Elaine's heart that she didn't understand. It made no sense whatsoever, and she shared that with me. And when I put the two things together, it made sense. And it was just jaw-dropping. He confirmed it through two people who were committed to the house, committed to me, committed to doing the work of God. And when I realized what God was saying, it was just amazing. So the word, I'll try and make it a little bit clearer. The words that Kevin had, or the word that Elaine had, was Alabama. And she didn't have no idea why. She had absolutely no idea. It meant nothing to her, but she said it to me. And it reminded me of the movie Forrest Gump. So I thought, well, I must watch that movie, because I haven't watched it for decades. So I found a copy, a DVD in the charity shop, watched it, and in the first 5 minutes, the same words that were given to Kevin to speak to me were in the film. And it wasn't my imagination. It came from two independent people at the same time after I'd prayed earnestly. And it just took my breath away. And so it spoke to me of the value of earnest prayer. When we're praying to God, if we're not complaining, you know, sometimes our prayers aren't really prayers. They're like complaints because we're not happy with what's happening. But when we pray according to eternal matters that we want to understand, God answers that kind of prayer. It reaches the throne of God. He accepted it, and he spoke to two people. And that's just, it still blows me away when I think about it. And there's so much information in that movie that confirms what I did was right. It's cost an awful lot of money, far more than it should have done. So the value of earnest prayer, and I just wanted to encourage everyone this morning in the value of earnest prayer. And it doesn't have to be about us. You know, the Bible says there's a harvest out there to be reached. And if we have a harvest, a heart to bring in the harvest, then we need to pray earnestly for people. We need to pray earnestly for people as to what we should say to them, that God would touch them. And God hears those types of prayer when we're about his business. And we need to recognize who God is speaking to, because some people can waste your time. And we need to be sensitive and to understand who God is speaking to and what is stopping them from responding to what God is doing. So I was thinking about about the Father's business and bad things happen, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, because sometimes we can do that. Throw our toys out of the pram. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. God is doing a new thing, and God wants us to reach the harvest, to be bringing the harvest in. And you know, I was thinking that God answers prayers in so many ways. He can even speak to people that don't know him. I was reminded of Balaam, who was not an Israelite. He was a seer, a diviner. So tapping into evil things, not into the things of God. But God can speak. He spoke to Balaam and would not do what he was being asked to do, to send a curse upon the Israelites. So, you know, God will answer our prayers, and he can even speak to the ungodly and use them in the things that we need help with to get through our situations. So God chooses us. It's us that God has chosen to send us out, as he did with the disciples. God wants to anoint us with his power. But we have to be about his business. And we have to pray. And the prayer times on Wednesday are wonderful. And we're talking about having an all-night prayer. So we all felt that we wanted to do this. Not exactly sure when we're going to do it, but it needs to be organised because not everybody can obviously stay awake the whole night. But we want an all-night prayer. And that's something that I believe that people will want to be involved with. But the final area, the third area, talking about reaching the throne of God, touching the throne of God, is divine appointments. Divine appointments. As we're about the Father's business, you will have, if you're watching, you will have divine appointments. It's biblical. It's in the Bible, and I was reminded of the example of Philip. It says in Acts chapter 8 and verses 23 to 25. Acts chapter 8, 26 to 35. So this is after Jesus has been resurrected and gone to sit at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And it says, "Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, one of the disciples, saying, 'Arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.' This is desert. And so he arose and went. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning. And sitting in his chariot, he was reading," the Ethiopian was reading Isaiah the prophet. "And the Spirit said to Philip, 'Go near and overtake the chariot.' And so Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, 'Do you understand what you are reading?' And he said, 'How can I unless someone guides me?' And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. The place in the scripture which he read was this: 'He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth.' So the eunuch answered Philip and said, 'I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or of some other man?' And then Philip opened his mouth and beginning at this scripture, preached Jesus to him." And so Philip had this divine appointment, and he had an interesting experience after he'd done his bit and witnessed to the Ethiopian and baptized him. Says the Bible, spirited him away. It's just amazing. He suddenly appeared in another place. Amazing. Nothing is impossible with God. And that's because he was obedient to what God was saying to him. Do you know, I was thinking that we have to be in the right place at the right time. We need to be in the right place at the right time. And unless our commitment is to eternal matters and not natural matters, we're not going to be in the right place at the right time. And you know, when we pray to God, we I was thinking our heart needs to be right. It needs to be, we need to be expecting to hear the answer. Because sometimes we pray and we forget that we've prayed, don't we? And we start thinking about natural things and getting involved in natural things. We even forget that we prayed. I'm guilty of that, I must admit. And when Kevin shared what he said, shared what the dream that he'd had, and Elaine said, shared what the word that she'd been given, it reminded me that I'd been praying. It actually reminded me that I'd been praying, and then it all fell into place. So we need to be in the right place at the right time, and we need to be expecting to hear from God. Because God is real, and God wants to speak to us. It's jaw-dropping. I don't know why, but it is jaw-dropping when he does, because it's not of this realm. And so to us, it just affects you inside when you realize that God is speaking and answering prayer. And it's what he calls us to. He's chosen us to be involved with his business in eternal matters. That's the phrase that I can't get away from. That we need to be involved in eternal matters and stop being satisfied with natural matters, because we've been called to be about his business, God's business. But we have to be in the right place in our heart to hear what God is saying. In Matthew chapter 10, Matthew chapter 10 and verses 17 to 20, when Jesus sent the disciples out, Matthew chapter 10 again, verses 17 to 20, he said, but beware of men, for they will cause you problems. They will deliver you up to councils and scourge you in their synagogues. You will be brought before governors and kings for my sake, as a testimony to them and to the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, do not worry about how or what you should speak. Hey, can you imagine? You've been delivered up to somebody really important, perhaps some authority, who knows what they're talking about. And it says, Jesus said, it will be given to you in that hour what you should speak. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. Do you know, that needs trust. That needs calmness. If you start worrying, if you start becoming anxious, which would be the natural thing to happen, you would not be able to hear what the Spirit is saying. We need to be calm. We need to trust God. The Holy Spirit needs us to be calm and in a right place of peace, so that we can receive the instruction of God. And that's true when we're reaching people, talking to people about God. We need to be calm and listening to what God is saying. You know, it says in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 16, just immediately the verse before, might as well have read it. It said, behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Therefore be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And the dove is speaks of peace, doesn't it? A dove will not settle where there is a commotion going on. So it's the dove speaks to us of being calm and being at peace. Amen. So I believe that God wants us to be involved, each one of us, in the eternal, in his eternal purposes, and reaching the throne of God and involved, throwing ourselves into the things, the eternal things of God in these days. And I do believe that God wants to do a new work, and he wants us to be focused not on us. He wants our worship. He wants our worship before him. He desires that. But he wants that harvest bringing in. He wants that harvest bringing in. And he's chosen us to do that. And we need to respond to that, don't we? And not get involved in the lesser things of this life. I know that it's difficult. People that have been helping me know that I'm struggling with certain things that are happening. But we have to trust. And we have to be ready to hear God and not look at the wind and the waves of the things that are happening around us. Amen. So I'll just close in prayer. Father, I just want to thank you that you have chosen each one of us here today, Lord God, that it was your desire to, and your good purpose, Lord, to bring us into your care and your keeping, that we are kept by your power. Lord, I just pray that we would be able to trust you in the things that have the potential to take us away from you. Lord, I pray that we would be calm and we would seek you, that we would pray each one, Lord, to you of our desire, Lord, to involve ourselves in your business and to hear you, Lord God, as you accept our prayers before you. Thank you for what you're doing in these days. Lord, I pray for each person here today that you would pour your spirit upon them, Lord, that you would talk to them, and that, Lord, each one of us would give our hearts again to you, to serve you, and to involve ourselves in your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I hope you will join us for the prayer meeting on Wednesday evening. That's 7:30 in the church. And join us for tea and coffee and biscuits and cake if you're able to. And have a great week. And bless you. Amen.